arid and semi-arid regions in general, and specifically here in the Sonoran Desert, surface water resources are really scarce, and they're becoming increasingly scarce as we move forward into the future. And that's because we have urbanization, we have more people living here using up these water resources, and we also have changes in precipitation patterns. There are artificial sources of water that's helping to augment these natural flows. And in some cases, they're recreating flow in previously dry portions of rivers and streams. And that's thanks to treated wastewater discharge. Here in the city of Tucson, there are two water reclamation facilities. They treat all of our sewage, and then the majority of that water, that treated effluent as it's known, is discharged directly into the Santa Cruz River.
We just kind of started going out to the river, different parts of the river, picking up rocks, looking at what bugs we saw. The river is obviously different from all other streams around here, natural streams, because it's completely dependent on treated wastewater or effluent to flow. And so that's one of the reasons why aquatic ecologists kind of ignored it in the past, because it was seen as like a second-class ecosystem, one that wasn't as healthy or as vibrant as other ecosystems. We knew that there had been wastewater treatment plant upgrades in the recent years, so there was some indication that the health of the river was improving, and we just basically set out to see what that looked like on the ground.
We've ran into rattlesnakes on the river. We've gone from 115 degree sampling days in the middle of the summer where we can't keep the sweat out of our eyes to sampling in the middle of the winter where the water is actually quite cold really early in the morning.
Seems like it'll be a chunky one too.
Yeah. Almost immediately, we saw some of the strange dynamics in the river. One of the prominent ones in that is that the flow varies with our water use in Tucson. During the day, when people are awake, washing dishes, using showers, the bathroom, the water levels going into the treatment plants are high. So the treated water coming out of it is also high. So the flow is high in the river. Then at night, everybody goes to sleep, except for the people working at night. Very little water gets used. And so the amount of water coming in the treatment plants is low. So therefore the amount of water in the river is low. So it has this pretty dramatic cycle from day to night. So we were curious if the operation of the treatment plants and the water use patterns in Tucson was impacting or limiting the diversity that we were seeing in the Santa Cruz. So that was the initial goal that we set out to study.
Not a lot is known about these effluent dominated river systems, like here in the Santa Cruz. So we wanted to look at the aquatic invertebrates to tell a better picture of what's happening here in the river. Aquatic invertebrates are the bugs and the insects and crustaceans that live in the river. And they're known as bioindicators. Looking at what's living in the river can tell us a lot about the overall health of the river.
And in that early sample, we ended up finding about 40 species of aquatic invertebrates. And I think at that point, probably only 20 or 25 had ever been reported from the river in total. So that was really an indication that, okay, this is an unnatural system, but it's obviously more diverse than we've given it credit for, largely thanks to the wastewater treatment plant upgrades in 2013. However, finding 40 species in a river, even though that was amazing for the Santa Cruz, is not amazing for a natural river ecosystem. We've got a little mix of everybody in the lab. So we've got grad students, undergrads, and postdocs. I like to say as a rule of thumb, for every hour we get to spend outside playing in the water, we spend 8 hours back in the lab actually turning those observations into data.
So we collect these aquatic invertebrate samples from these different sites in the river. We take them back to the laboratory and we look at them under the microscope. In that process, though, we started seeing these brightly colored objects under the microscope. All sorts of really bright colors, reds, whites, greens, blues, oranges, some of them even have sparkles in them. And we realize that we're looking at microplastics in our samples.
They really grab your attention. And then even some of the irregular plastics that are broken down from bigger pieces of plastics, they don't look like the pieces of wood or minerals and rocks that you get in your samples.
It was never our intention to collect or start looking at microplastics, but inadvertently, we're collecting sometimes large quantities, large concentrations of these microplastic pieces that are in our local river system here in the lower Santa Cruz River. Any microplastics that go down our drains at home here in Tucson, they end up going to the water reclamation facilities. And with the modern treatment standards that we have now, wouldn't be uncommon to have 95% removal rate of these microplastics prior to the treated effluent that's discharged into the environment. But because the concentrations of microplastics are so enormous, even 5% that's left over can still represent a large amount of microplastics, especially over time as it all adds up. We have those microfibers that are going down the drains when we wash our clothes. We have potentially microplastic beads in personal care products that go down our sinks and our shower drains, and they end up going to the river. But then you also have litter out on the landscape, especially when it comes to single-use plastics. So you have cups and lids and straws and plastic bottles and of plastic bags, for example. If they're not disposed of properly, if they're not recycled properly, if they're littered out on the landscape, eventually those make their way down gradient from wind and rainwater runoff into our river and stream systems. And so they go from maybe a plastic bottle to thousands, maybe hundreds of thousands of small plastic pieces as they break down over time. Then they can spread even more easily into the environment and get into the sediment and into the rivers and streams.
To us, the amount of plastics seemed extreme when we were looking at those initial samples. But when we compare the amount of plastics that other researchers are finding in other rivers, the Santa Cruz really isn't all that high, especially considering that none of its flow during non-rainy times is natural, right? So 100% of that flow is coming from the treatment plant, and we know that the treatment plant water has plastics in it. And yet, what we see in the Santa Cruz plastic-wise is pretty similar to what you'd see in a river that's 80 or 90% natural flow and only has a small contribution from a wastewater treatment plant.
These artificial stream systems, like the Santa Cruz River, that are supported by effluent, are the future. These surface water resources are incredibly important to the biodiversity, not just the things that live in the water themselves, not just the fish and the aquatic insects, but they're important for the larger ecosystems as a whole. So all the mammals, the birds, the plants, the trees, the riparian habitat. And so because of that, it's important to study these systems from scientific research perspective, but also from environmental managers.
We need to get the data to show the real value of putting this water in these washes and these dry riverbeds, so that 5 or 10 years from now, when the price of that effluent is up and the demand is up, that we can say, you know, this is why we need it in the ecosystem, this is why we need it in the riverbed. If we don't make the economic argument for the value of this ecosystem, the value of these effluent-dependent rivers, then some competing use will win and they'll take that water out of the river.